So there's only two types of people in the world. That's it. From God's perspective, there's only two types of people. Those in Adam, still in their sin, and those in Christ, holy and blameless. I was trying to think of how a way to illustrate position in it. I know it's such a simple concept, but right a few minutes ago, I was sitting over there, I was worshiping and praising, and now my new position is here standing before you preaching. This position I can change. I can go back over there and sit down, and I can change my position over and over and over again. This position in Christ never changes. Never changes. If you have Christ as Savior, the way God views you is as a son or daughter reconciled to Him, and nothing can change that. Nothing can snatch that out of His hand.
Abounding in Faith is the broadcast ministry of Emmanuel Bible Church of Howell, New Jersey. If you are blessed by this message, please subscribe to our podcast or YouTube channel. You can also download our app by searching for IBCNJ in the Google Play Store or the Apple Store. For more information, please visit us at www.ibcnj.org. Our speaker today is Pastor Mike Hurd.
What a glorious morning to come and worship the King. Amen. Oh, it's so good to be in the house of the Lord. So good to have our minds replenished and revitalized in the goodness of who God is, how much He loves us, and how He never fails us. This morning's message I labeled is our battle plan, from Colossians 3, 1 through 3. Let's read the Word of God, and we'll get into the message. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this morning, for this opportunity to gather in your name. We thank you for this precious gift, your word, and your Holy Spirit. And Lord, we just ask by faith that you would meet us here this morning. Lord, that you would speak to us so clearly. And Father, that you would change us for your honor and glory. We love you, Lord, and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, please be seated. Please be seated. So, we're going to look at Colossians chapter 3. And so, when Joe asked me to preach this week, I spent a lot of time in prayer and just asking the Lord, please, Father, direct my heart. I just want to speak on your behalf. And he always kind of leads me in a direction of how he's already previously worked in my life. And through certain passages and certain texts, they've really changed my life and the direction of my life. And I picked this text because of what a blessing it's been to me. And I'm finding the more and the longer I walk with Jesus Christ, I find that there are certain things in my life that hinder my relationship with Christ. And then there are things in my life that make me flourish in my relationship with Christ. Has everybody experienced that? And so I want to challenge you this morning. Our text here this morning, I believe, gives us a battle plan on how to keep our relationship with Christ sweet. And before we get into our text in Colossians chapter 3, I just want to describe a little bit about what Colossians is all about and give you a little bit of context around Colossians chapter 3. Look with me at Colossians chapter 1. Paul writes this letter to a fledgling church in Colossae. It's a church that he's never visited, probably started by Epaphroditus, who was a young believer who probably heard the gospel in Ephesus when Paul was preaching there, went to Colossae and now shares the gospel, and now we have this fledgling church starting up. And so Paul writes this letter in that context, in the idea that they're facing some false teaching. And what Paul really stresses throughout this book is the gospel. The fullness of the gospel, right? Not just that, listen to this, The fullness of the gospel, what I mean by that is not that we're just saved from hell to go to heaven, but we're given this beautiful new identity, present tense. That God, when we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, something beautiful happens in how God sees us. And so, look at Colossians chapter 1, and notice how Paul really stresses that in this letter. In Colossians chapter 1, look at verses 19 through 22 with me. 19 through 22. It says this, "For in him," that's Jesus Christ, "all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. And you who were once alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you how? Holy and blameless and above reproach before him." Look at this beautiful passage, and this is Paul's message in Colossians. He's trying to just inform this church, this fledgling church, of the fullness of the gospel. If you look at verse 20, you see the gospel there. It's that Christ, we're reconciled through Christ, through the cross, through the blood of the cross. He reminds them of this precious gospel, how they're saved, and then he reminds them of who they once were and who they are now. Look at verse 21, right? "And you were alienated, you were hostile in mind, doing evil deeds." That's how who they were before Christ, and now look at the verse 21, or verse 22. The present tense is now they're reconciled, holy, and blameless. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that an amazing message? So they went from formerly alienated to reconciled. They went from hostile in mind to doing evil deeds to holy and blameless. Reminding them of the fullness of the gospel, that we're not just saved from hell to heaven, but we have this new identity. Do you realize this morning of this new identity you have in Christ? That's why Paul's writing this, is that we would understand that in Christ we are now seen as holy and blameless. I don't know if that blows you away, but that never ceases to blow me away. Look at Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. And you'll see, again, Paul stresses this point about this new identity in Christ. Verse 13, it says, "And you, who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross." He reminds them again of this beautiful standing of who, what we have in Christ. Look at the past tense, right, in verse 13. "You were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, but God made us alive with him, having forgiven all our trespasses." It's amazing when you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, guys. There's this incredible transaction that takes place. Think about this. We go from aliens, we go from enemies of God. And then there's that point where we receive Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit comes and dwells us, and now we go from this to this new position in Christ, holy and blameless, reconciled, a child of God. What an amazing truth that Paul is writing to this Colossian church and reminding us of who we are in Christ. And the beautiful thing about it, guys, is we don't earn this. We don't work for this. Look at verse 14 again. Look at verse 14. How did this come about? How did God do this? By canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he did, he set it aside, nailing it to the cross. God paid our sin debt through the death, burial, and resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ. That's good news. And Paul's reminding them of this incredible truth that Jesus paid our sin debt, a debt that we could never repay. Has anybody ever seen the movie Bruce Almighty? All right, remember, maybe if nobody's ever seen it, remember when Bruce walks up to this file cabinet? And in that file cabinet, according to God, is all his actions, all his sinful actions, and all the mistakes he's made in his life. And he looks at this little file cabinet, he says, hey, I'm not too bad. This is pretty good. And then he goes to open the file cabinet, and whomp! The file cabinet takes him all the way across this floor. It's about 100 feet long, and it has all the sins that he's committed in his life. And that's us. Now think about what this verse is saying. That whole debt is gone. That whole debt has been paid for through the blood and sacrifice of Jesus Christ when we put our faith in that. That's the gospel. That's the fullness of the gospel that Paul is reminding this Colossian church about this morning. When I think about Jesus paying the debt, I think of that old hymn. Now, mind my singing. Jesus paid it all. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Whew. Amazing. Amazing, guys. Jesus paid our full sin debt. And so here to this fledgling church, Paul is trying to remind them of this new identity in Jesus Christ that they have, the fullness of this gospel. And he does the same thing in our passage this morning, again in Colossians chapter 3. The only thing he does is something a little different in our passage this morning. He talks about their identity in Christ, but then he adds also, so he talks about their position in Christ. And you'll see it in your notes if you're keeping notes. And then he talks about the plan to walk in that position. And then he talks about a promise. Then he talks about this beautiful promise. So look with me at Colossians chapter 3. Let's look at it again. This is where we started. And first he talks about this position again that they have in Christ. He reminds them once again, like in chapter 1 and like in chapter 2, he explains this new position that they have. Look at verse 1 with me. He says, you have been raised in Christ. Notice the past tense. You have been raised. They weren't raised previously. When a person receives Christ as Lord and Savior, they go from death to life. And he reminds them of how they have now been raised. When God sees a believer, he sees them as already raised in Christ. That's their new identity. They go from death to life. They go from sin to holy and blameless. They go from living in Adam to being in Christ. And so he reminds them of how they're raised in Christ. That's such an important phrase there, in Christ. It's when you receive Christ, you are actually in a whole new realm. God saw you once as a sinner, as an enemy, rebellious. After Christ, he sees you as a whole new creation. Guys, this is how he sees you right now. I don't care what you did this morning. I don't care how you sinned yesterday. When you receive Jesus Christ, this is how God views you. This is our position, and this is what Paul is trying to pour into them. I love what Corinthians says. Listen to 1 Corinthians. It says this, for as by a man came death, that's Adam, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. Isn't that beautiful? I don't think you're paying attention. No, I'm just kidding. So there's only two types of people in the world. That's it. From God's perspective, there's only two types of people. Those in Adam, still in their sin, raised, and those in Christ, holy and blameless. Amazing, amazing. The beautiful thing about this position, I was trying to think of how a way to illustrate position, and it, I know it's such a simple concept, but right a few minutes ago I was sitting over there, I was worshiping and praising, and now my new position is here standing before you preaching, right? The beautiful thing is this position I can change. I can go back over there and sit down, and I can change my position over and over and over again. This position in Christ never changes. Never changes. If you have Christ as Savior, the way God views you is as a son or daughter reconciled to Him, and nothing can change that. Nothing can snatch that out of His hand. That's amazing good news. That's amazing good news. And that's what Paul is reminding him here. Look at the second position in verse 3. He reminds them first, right, that they've been raised with Christ. Then he reminds them again that you have died in Christ. Right? God no longer sees us. We are dead. We are dead. Our old man is dead. That's why Paul in Colossians could say, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. That's why 2 Corinthians says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Right, Pat? All right? That's our memory verse with some of the guys that I meet with on Thursday morning. That's our memory verse. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Whew. Amazing. Amazing. And then he reminds them, too, of how this takes place in verse 3. Our third position in Christ that he reminds them, these believers, of is your life is hidden with Christ in God. And I know I'm kind of repetitious, I'm repeating myself, but this is what Paul is writing to the Colossian church. He's beating them over the head because our instinct is not to believe this, right? He tells them your life is hidden with Christ in God. So when God, think about this. Right now, God doesn't see me. I'm hidden in Christ. If you're here and you're a believer, right now, God doesn't see you. You're hidden in Christ. He sees you as His son, as His daughter. You have all the rights and privileges that the Son of God has. We have all the same riches, the same position. That is just an incredible, incredible truth. We have been raised in Christ, we have died, and our lives are hidden with Christ. That's our new fixed position. That's our new fixed position that nothing can change. But now I really want to get into the meat of the text, and why I'm so passionate about this passage is because now what God does is, now that we understand our position in Christ, He gives us a plan on how to live out that new position in Christ. He gives us a plan. Look with me at our passage in Colossians chapter 3. And He does it again in three phrases, right? He says in verse 1, He says, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Seek the things that are above. That's the command. Seek the things of heaven. That word seek is in the present imperative, which is a command to do something in the future and involves continuous or repeated action. The NASB does a phenomenal job with this translation because it says, keep on seeking the things that are above. We're not supposed to stop seeking the things that are above. Daily in our lives, we're supposed to seek the things above. Every moment of every day, we're supposed to be seeking the things above. This is how we have victory over the flesh and over the world and over the devil. Continually seeking that which is above. Look at verse 2. Set your minds on the things that are above. That word set means to strive, to earnestly seek after. So we have this plan of ours that God has given to this Colossian believers and to us is to seek the things that are above, to set your minds on the things that are above. Two commands, seek and set. And I'm challenged by what does this look like in our daily lives, right? We have this daily routine. I have to go to work. I have to do this. I have to raise my family. I have all these daily routines. So what does it look like to really set our minds on the things above? And how, I just want to stress how important this is. Listen to what Proverbs 23:7 says. For as he thinks in his heart, so is he. What we think leads to how we act. Do you hear that? This is so important in our Christian life. What we think leads to how we act. A person's behavior is determined by what they think in their heart. It's so important that we understand this, because so much of Christianity, you can't tell the difference between the world and the church. And what Paul is expressing here is he's given us a plan on how to separate ourselves from looking like the world. And that plan is by setting our minds on the things above. Setting our minds on the things above. There's a book by the Puritans. It's called God's Battle Plan for the Mind. And it's so important. The rest of the title is the Puritan practice of Bible meditation. How important is it as Christians that we fill our minds with the truth and the reality of God and who He is? Right? Romans 12:2 says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Guys, if you read that verse really, really closely, we can be, as believers, we can be conformed to the world. We can just look like the rest of the world. But the more we renew our minds with the truth of God's word, right, we're transformed. We're transformed. Look one more time, and I got to finish up. Look one more time with verse 2, because this is really what I want to, this is where I applied it to my own life. This is where I struggle. My confession to you guys. Look at verse 2. He says, set your minds on the things above, not on the things of the earth. This is my challenge to the church, to myself. Guys, what are you watching? What are you looking at? What are you allowing your mind to be filled with so that in turn you look more like the world than you do Jesus Christ? I'm really challenged by this. And I want to say this. I practiced this week. My wife's going to hate me. So I tried to turn off my devices. I tried to turn off the TV. I tried to separate myself from the things that I know can distract me and woo my heart away from this sweet relationship with Jesus Christ. And I'm going to share this with you. Man, it's awesome. The Puritans, I think, had it right. They weren't doing it to be legalist. They were doing it because they wanted to experience the sweetness of their Savior. And we do that. The more and more we separate and we allow our minds to be conformed to the things of God and not to the things of the world. You remember the old phrase, GIGO? Garbage in, garbage out? Remember that? It's the same thing with us. Listen to what this one, I looked up GIGO, and this is what they had to do, describe what it means. It is a concept that refers to the idea that the quality of a system's output is determined by the quality of its input. Is that pretty powerful? Think about that, guys, in our own lives, with our computers, right, our minds, right? Listen to what it says. It's the concept that refers to the idea that the ability of a system's output, the quality of the system's output is determined by the quality of its input. So what we put into our minds is how we're going to act. I remember when my kids were younger and their favorite show was the Ninja Turtles. And they would watch it for, it was really a good babysitting tool, wasn't it, honey? They would watch the Ninja Turtles for a while, and then they would turn the Ninja Turtles off, and what would they do for the next couple hours? It's like, wah! Right? They're throwing kicks, they're throwing pillows at each other, they're fighting, right? They just filled their mind with, and what did they become? What they filled their minds with. And guys, as I don't care how mature you are and how old you are, we need to be doing the same thing. We need to be filling our minds with the things of God and not of the things of this earth, so then in turn, we can reflect Jesus Christ to a lost and dying world. And we wonder why we don't experience joy in our lives. And I really believe, guys, is because we're allowing so much of the world to influence us instead of us influencing the world. Listen to Philippians 4:8-9. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things. Now listen, and the God of shalom will be with you. He tells us again, what we fill our minds with leads to how much peace we have in our lives. So if you're not experiencing the peace and the quality of a beautiful relationship with your living Savior, I'm asking you to form a plan. Set your minds not on the things of the earth, but on the things of heaven. And watch how your life changes, how your heart changes. I got a lot of message. I'm gonna finish with this. Last week, Steve Coffey gave a message. And the last thing he put on the screen, and I wrote it down because I'm going to probably hide it in my heart for the rest of my life, when Steve Coffey gave his message last week. And it said this: nurture your love for God. Nurture your love for God. How do we do that? We set our minds on the things above and not on the things of the earth. I looked up that word nurture, and it says care for and encourage the growth or development of. So I want to nurture, guys, think about this, my love for Christ. I love Jesus Christ with everything I got. And I want to nurture that love. I want it to become stronger and sweeter. And how do I do that? I form a plan. And that plan that Paul is writing here for us is to separate from the things of the world, from the things of the earth, and set your minds on the things of God. What a beautiful plan. What a beautiful plan. The last thing I want to look at is our promise. Look at verse 4 with me, and I'll finish with this. Look at verse 4. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Paul reminds them and us of our hope, our future with the Lord Jesus Christ, and the glory that we're going to share with him. Now, what is that glory that he's talking about here? And so I just went through a couple of passages just to kind of define what that word glory means in Christ. It includes our resurrection. It includes a heavenly inheritance. It includes every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. It includes the redemption of our bodies. This mortal will put on immortality. This corruption will put on incorruption. It includes the hope of righteousness. Can you imagine? Just imagine this. Never to battle the sin nature again. I don't know about you, but that's something I'm looking forward to. It includes no tears, no death, no mourning, no pain. And most of all, it includes Him. It includes Him. That's the glory that we're going to share with Jesus Christ. Is that good news? I love what, again, what Steve Coffey said last week in the middle of his message. He said he was home on furlough, and he spent time with his family, and he got a call from his father. And his father said, "Son, I got good news and I got bad news." And Steve said to his dad, "Dad, all right, give me the bad news first." And his father said, "Hey, son, I got cancer. I only got a few more months to live." Steve took that in. And he said, "Dad, what's the good news?" "I'm getting to go see my Savior." That's the glory that we're going to share. That's the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. So let me just kind of review real quickly, just to kind of remember, constantly renew your minds with the truth of who you are in Christ. Please, constantly renew your minds. I have to do this every day. I wake up and I tell myself the gospel every day, because I know who I am, I know how broken I am, and I know how sinful I am, and I know my heart, my selfishness, and my pride. And I wake up every morning and I have to say, "Lord, I can't believe it. You died in my place. I am holy and blameless this morning before you. I'm your son that you love unconditionally. And Lord, I want to walk in that truth." And so this is the invitation, is to understand your position in Christ. Right? Understand the promise that we have of glory. And because of that, I'm asking you each, please, to come up with a plan, a strategy, to how to nurture your love for Christ. Let's pray. Father, we love you, we thank you, and we praise you because of your everything we just kind of went over, Lord. It leaves us at times speechless that you would love us with this incredible love expressed through your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, our prayer this morning is that we would nurture our love with you. And Lord, that we would find ways to really build up this relationship that we have with you and be more separate from the world and more set apart for you. Father, and the only reason for that is, yes, it brings us peace. Yes, it brings us joy. Yes, it is sweet. But Lord, ultimately, we want to do it for your glory so that you would be made famous. So help us, Father, in this endeavor. Help us to come up with a plan. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for listening to the previous message. We pray that you were blessed by it. For more information, please visit us at www.ibcnj.org.